Good morning. So today, in taking our understanding of multilateral instruments further, we would be looking at how some of India's largest trading partners, being Singapore or UK or Japan, have adopted this MLI, and how the DTA regime post the adoption of MLI by these three jurisdictions, with specific reference to the DTA between Japan, Singapore and UK, are likely to pan out. So let's quickly move on. As Ms. Customary, I would like to thank Thirumal and Jugal for having got the presentation done for us today. These are some of the terms. I think most of it is something which we have already covered in earlier sessions, but yes, we shall be spending time on these as and when we move on. So this is the schema for the day. A quick peek on MLI and the flexibility it provides us, and the applicability of MLI, hybrid mismatches. So as for those of us who've already been through, MLI provisions are split into seven categories. So for each of these seven categories, we shall look at what is the position of India in that, what is the position of the other three countries, and post MLI applicability, how the DTA provisions will get applied in the MLI regime. So these are the articles. So as far as MLI is concerned, the entire scheme of provisions are split as seven categories: applicability, hybrid mismatches, prevention of treaty abuse, avoidance of permanent establishment status, dispute resolution, arbitration, and final provisions. These seven categories are comprised in 35 articles. This is a MLI is a birth child of OECD, where the intent was to prevent base erosion and profit shifting. So the fundamental purpose of MLI was to bring down tax avoidance and increase the cooperation amongst entities. As you are aware, OECD has about 30 odd members, but when it came to MLI, there were about 90 plus members countries who came together and brought out these provisions. And each of these signatories is required to ratify the MLI in their own jurisdiction. And post ratification, after a cooling period of 3 months, these provisions become law. And MLIs do not amend existing treaties. They only need to be read along with existing treaties. So from a tax parlance, when you look at it, MLIs would mainly be your explanation or proviso in a section. So the PR section is your DTAA, and MLIs are your explanations or proviso as far as each of these sections are concerned. What are the flexibilities primarily what an MLI offers? Of course, we've done this in detail across 6 weeks earlier. MLI suggests alternate provisions, optional provisions, and areas where countries have an option to not apply the MLI provisions. However, when it comes to prevention of treaty abuse and improvement of dispute resolution, MLI provisions are mandatory. So these are the minimum standards which the MLI provides for. But for the remaining five categories, be it hybrid mismatches or arbitration, all the provisions are only recommendatory in nature. So let's quickly run through the agenda. As far as applicability of MLI is concerned, all the four jurisdictions what we are looking at, including India, have signed these agreements on 7th of June 2017, whereas the other three countries have ratified it in 2018. And the ratified instrument has been deposited. As far as India is concerned, this has happened only by 25th of June. And the entry into force as far as India is concerned is only effective 1st of October 2019. So at this point in time, all the three agreements what we are talking about are covered tax agreements as far as MLI is concerned, as from an Indian perspective. Let's look at hybrid mismatches. So Article 3, which deals with fiscally transparent entity, as far as India's position is concerned, India reserves a right for entirety of Article 3 not to apply. And when you look at Article 3, just to give you a quick peek, any income derived through a fiscally transparent entity shall be considered to be the income of a resident of a contracting jurisdiction, but only to the extent that the income is treated as income of a resident of that contracting jurisdiction for tax purposes. And the provisions of the covered tax agreement, CTA stands for covered tax agreement, that require a country of residence to provide exemption or credit of income tax on which income may be taxed in the other state shall not apply to the extent such provisions allow taxation by the other state only because the income is also derived by a resident of that other state. So fundamentally, when it comes to transparent entity, India says it will not apply. Moment India says it will not apply, the DTAA between each of these three countries, we don't even need to look into that. Article 3 will not apply to all the three jurisdiction DTAAs. Please understand, we are again looking at, from a conceptual standpoint, MLI is one step above the DTAA. If certain, and any provision in MLI needs to be read alongside the DTAA. But if a country has made a specific reservation that this particular provision will not apply to the ML to its DTAAs, then there is no point in looking at the counterparty provision, because MLI says if one of the jurisdictions says it will not apply, the provision will not apply. Dual resident entities. This is where your POEM provisions come into picture. As far as India is concerned, India has no reservations. And what India has done, India has notified Article 4.2 of Japan's DTAA in the treaty with Japan as part of its covered tax agreement. With Singapore, it has not done anything of that sort. And again, with UK, it has done Article 4.3 of the covered tax agreement. So let's look at the implications on the covered tax agreement by virtue of India's notification. If you look at Article 4.2 of the Indo-Japan DTAA shall now be replaced by Para 1 of Article 4 of MLI. Now, what does it mean? It means where an entity is considered resident in two jurisdictions as per the covered tax agreement, competent authorities shall mutually determine the residence. In the absence of any agreement, entity shall not be entitled for any relief under DTAA. This is very clear. So if by virtue of POEM guidelines, a Japanese entity is regarded as an Indian resident, then this is what we typically call in an individual scenario a tiebreaker test. But when it comes to a corporate entity, the mechanism was mutual agreement procedure. If the entities do not do not come to a consensus by virtue of bilateral negotiations, in such scenarios, the way this works is the relief under DTAA will not be applicable to the SSE. And Singapore reserves for a right to not apply Article 4. So therefore, the provisions of Article 4 will not apply to India-Singapore DTAA. Again, UK has not made any reservation. And India has notified Article 4.3 of the covered tax agreement. So 4.3 of India-UK DTAA shall be replaced by Para 1 of MLI. So similar to what we have seen, where an entity is considered as a resident in both the jurisdictions, the competent authorities shall determine the residential status or agree to provide relief in any other specified manner. So this is typically how MLI operates, friends. So going forward, as we speak now, if you are going to give an opinion or looking at a transaction, a bilateral transaction, not only from an Indian perspective, but from literally 3,000 plus treaties are now amended, you would have to look at what is the position each of these jurisdictions have taken under the MLI regime. Next, Article 5, methods for elimination of double tax avoidance agreement. India's position, choice to apply option C, which is credit method for all incomes. And when you look at Japan, none of the options have been chosen. Singapore reserves the right to not apply this article at all. UK again, none of the options will happen. So what is the implication? Now, option C, which is a credit method, will apply to Indian residents as far as Japan and UK are concerned, because since Singapore is reserved not to apply this, so MLI will not have any impact as far as India-Singapore DTAA is concerned. So you need to understand, no impact does not mean no credit or anything of that sort. You will go only with the treaty provisions. So MLI is not much of relevance as far as that particular article between the country is concerned. Next, Article 6, purpose of the covered tax agreement. Now, when you look at it, the original intent of the covered tax agreement was only to ensure double taxation is avoided. It did not prevent double non-taxation, or it did not prevent treaty abuse, or it did not provide for development of economic relationship or enhancing cooperation in tax matters. Now, what India has done, India has accepted Article 6 as such. So what now, consequent to this acceptance, the preamble would stand amended to state, purpose of a DTA intending to eliminate double taxation with respect to taxes covered by this agreement without creating opportunities for non-taxation or reduced taxation through tax evasion or avoidance, including through treaty shopping arrangements aimed at obtaining relief provided in this agreement. So you would now notice the purpose of a DTA is now far higher than what it was, far wider, I would say, than what it was. The intent now looks to be to ensure there is no abuse of treaty provisions apart from providing for tax relief. Now, as far as Japan is concerned, para 1 of Article 6 should not apply to the CTA that already contain the prescribed text. So which effectively means that Article 6 applies, optional additional preamble text will not apply. So the additional preamble text talks about economic cooperation and cooperation in tax matters. Singapore chooses to apply optional additional preamble text, so that would apply. So as far as India-Singapore treaty, the additional text will apply. And UK para 1 will not apply to CTA that already contain the prescribed preamble, which is fair, because if it is already there in the treaty, there is no need to use the MLI provisions to add. And as far as the additional optional additional provision is concerned, UK chooses to apply this. So this is only going to interpret the provisions of DTA from a larger perspective, friends. Next, Article 7, prevention of treaty abuse. India accepts principal purpose test. PPT stands for principal purpose test, which has also been included in explanation to section 9. You would see when the definition of the term business connection has been explained, the principal purpose test is now added. Chooses to apply simplified limit LOB, limitation of benefits clause. Japan has not made any reservations. Singapore chooses to apply the provision in para 4, which is reconsideration of cases rejected on account of principal purpose test. And UK chooses to apply optional provision in para 4, which again is reconsideration of cases rejected on account of principal purpose test. Now, what is the effect on the CTA? The PPT, as far as Japan and Singapore are concerned, PPT principal purpose test will apply as an interim measure. PPT shall supersede CTA provisions to the extent of incompatibility where there is a notification mismatch. Simplified LOB will not apply as both have to choose, and only India has chosen, the other two countries have not chosen. The optional provision, which is reconsideration of cases rejected, will not apply because India has not chosen that. Again, when you look at the UK, India-UK DTAA, Article 28C of the CTA will be replaced. PPT will be applied as an interim measure, and it shall supersede the provisions of the DTA to the extent of incompatibility, as there is a notification mismatch. Similarly, simplified LOB will not apply since both have not chosen it. An optional provision in para 4 will not apply as both have to choose this as well. When again, for the interest of those who do not understand, who are new to this concept of notification mismatch, if one country notifies a provision and the other country does not notify the provision of MLI, then it becomes a notification mismatch. Article 8 on dividend transfer transactions. So India reserves the right Article 8 to not apply to CTA that already contain minimum holding period longer than 365 days. Japan reserves the right for entirety of Article 8 to not apply. I think all the three countries have decided that. So therefore, Article 8 will not apply. So there is no point in discussing that. Again, Article 9, capital gains from alienation of shares or interest of entities deriving their value principally from immovable property. So India chooses to apply para 4 of Article 9, and where para 4 of Article 9 states that gain on shares, capital gain on shares or comparable interest shall be taxable in the jurisdiction in which the immovable property is situated at any time during the 365 days prior to transfer of the shares or interest which derives more than 50% of value therefrom from immovable property. So this is again taxation of indirect capital gains where the underlying asset is an immovable asset. So look at a case where a Singaporean company owns an immovable asset in India, and that immovable, the value of the company is derived predominantly, when I say predominantly, in excess of 50% is derived from the immovable property located in India. Then in such a case, India says that India will have a right to tax at source. Now, India chooses to apply para 4. Japan has also chosen to apply para 4. Singapore obviously reserves not to apply para 4. And UK has also had a similar provision. So in this scenario, Singapore and UK, no-brainer, since they both have not accepted para 4, this will not apply. As far as Japan, India, Japan is concerned, the para 4 will apply since both the jurisdictions have chosen. And it shall supersede the provisions of cover tax agreement to the extent of incompatibility. Next, anti-abuse rules for PEs situated in third country jurisdictions. Obviously, India and Japan have not had any reservations. And Singapore and UK have taken the other position where they say this will not, they are not in sync with this provision. Again, friends, you can look at Singapore, UK, US, all these jurisdictions have some of the largest offshores in the world. So if you look at it, US is not part of the MLI regime. UK, of course, as much as they are part of it, they still make a ton of money from their offshore regime. So which is why they are not too much in favor of provisions which stifle the offshores. Next. So since there is no notification made by both India, reservation made by both India and Japan, Article 10 would apply. So typically, which means where a company in the country of residence earn income from the country of source, and such income is attributed to a PE in a third country jurisdiction, and such income is exempt from tax in the country of residence, and the treaty benefits would be denied if the tax rate in PE country is less than 60% of the tax rate in the country of residence. Income would be taxable in the country of source, notwithstanding other provisions. So look at an Indian company doing business in Japan through a subsidiary in, let's say, Mauritius. And the Mauritius and the income is attributed to the subsidiary in Mauritius. And Mauritius tax rate, the effective tax rate in Mauritius is 2.5%. Though they say the headline tax rate is 15%, the effective tax rate is 2.5%. And so if we were to strictly interpret by the spirit of the MLI provision, the 2.5% is less than the provisions of 60% of the tax rate in India, in which case Article 10, being the anti-abuse provision, shall apply as far as Indo-Japan treaty is concerned. This will not apply, however, for UK and Singapore. Next, application of tax agreements to restrict a party's right to tax its own residence. India has not made any reservation. Japan, Singapore have said that this will not apply, and UK only. UK, similar to India, has not made any reservation. So as far as India, Japan, India, Singapore, Article 11 shall not apply. India, UK 11 shall apply and shall supersede the provisions of cover tax agreement, which effectively means the CTA provisions would not affect a jurisdiction's right to tax its own residents, except in specific circumstances, which is there in your savings clause. So going forward, like how US has a global right to tax its citizens, countries which have accepted Article 11 would now say that they have a global right to tax its residents, irrespective of the bilateral convention, provided there is an MLI match. I would say. Next, avoidance of PE status. Artificial avoidance of PE status through commissioner arrangements and similar arrangements. We have seen these provisions gradually seep through in India via your Section 9 business connection, where independent agents or dependent agents, the scope of work to be performed by an agent, all these provisions have been dealt with. Similarly, as far as India is concerned, India has welcomed the provisions of Article 12, Japan also, so no reservations. But Singapore and UK have categorically stated they will not apply Article 12 to its treaties. What does it mean? Article 12 would apply to India-Japan treaty, and para 1 would replace Article 5-7, which defines the term, which 5-7a, and para 2 would replace Article 5-8. Para 1 deems an agent who exclusively work for an entity as its PE, and para 2 exempts independent agents in its normal course of business. And no change as far as India, Singapore and India, UK, DTAA. Article 13, artificial avoidance of PE through specific activity exemptions. Again, this is just a similar scenario where if activities are in the nature of preparatory or auxiliary in nature, there are certain exceptions being provided for the entity being a PE. We have seen that in detail when we discussed Article 13 in our MLI regime, so I don't want to get into it at this point now. Position India chooses to apply option A, which states that any specific activity exemption or any place would not be deemed to be a PE only if it is preparatory or auxiliary in nature. And Japan chooses to use option A, and there is no reservation against anti-fragmentation rule. So the fragmentation rule is typically you are supposed to do a series of five activities, and instead of doing all the five activities in one entity, because if the five activities together constitute a PE, typical purpose intent would be to split these five activities in five different entities and do it accordingly, or two or three activities in one entity and do the remaining in another. So India, I mean, MLI has provided for a provision on anti-fragmentation rule, and India has stated that we don't have any reservation on this anti-fragmentation rule. Japan has also taken a similar position. Singapore reserves, and it chooses to apply option B, and no reservation or choice made by UK. So what is the effect? The effect on the CTA, option A shall apply. Anti-fragmentation rule shall also apply to India-Japan DTAA. Singapore anti-fragmentation rule will not apply, and no option will apply because Singapore is stated out of its intent as far as this aspect of MLI is concerned. UK anti-fragmentation rule will apply since UK has not made a choice, and neither of the options shall apply because since UK has not selected anything. Next, or I would say yes. Article 14, splitting up of contract, very similar to your anti-fragmentation rule. India has not made any reservation. Japan reserves a right to not, all the other three countries have said they won't agree with this, or they would want to reserve the position. So, which typically means Article 14 will not apply to the MLIs, the DTAs between these three countries. Article 15 on definition of a person closely related to an enterprise. India and Japan have not made any reservation, and UK also. So Article 15 shall apply. Singapore has reserved, so Article 15 will not apply as far as Singapore is concerned. Next, dispute resolution. MAP. Mutual agreement procedure. So I'll quickly run through the provisions of Article 16, and then we shall look at the scenarios. Any action of a competent authority which is not in accordance with the CTA, the person may present a case to any one of the competent authorities, and the case must be presented within 3 years. The time frame is mentioned. The competent authority shall resolve the case through MAP with the other competent authority if the objection appears to be justified and if it is not able to arrive at a satisfactory solution. So if the authority is able to arrive at a satisfactory solution, then that solution becomes final. Implementation shall be made, the solution shall be implemented irrespective of the time limits in the domestic law. The competent authority shall endeavor to resolve by MAP any difficulties or doubts arising from the interpretation or application of the covered tax agreement, and they should consult together for elimination of double taxation in cases not provided for the CTA. So as far as India is concerned, India has taken the first sentence of para 1 to not apply. on the basis that it intends to meet the minimum standards required for improving dispute resolution under OECD G20 package. Japan and UK have not made any reservation, and accepting cases in resident country and initiating bilateral consultation is what is India's position as this is concerned. Singapore first sentence shall not apply, that it intends to meet similar to India. And again, for the second part also, it is willing to accept cases in resident country and initiating bilateral consultation. So now, what is the implication consequent to this? As far as India, Japan is concerned, though Article 16 shall not apply, the CTA already has MAP provision, same as the case with Singapore. India, UK, other MAP provisions already exist. So what gets added consequent to MLI would be the 3-year time frame for submission of cases, agreement to be implemented notwithstanding any time frame in domestic laws, and consult to each other for the elimination of double taxation in cases not provided by CTA. Next. Article 17, corresponding adjustment. This is a problem in Indian domestic tax law as well. We have secondary adjustments going on. So corresponding adjustments, India's position, India reserves a right not to apply to CTAs that already contain the provision for corresponding adjustment. All the other three countries say the provisions will not, they have no reservation. So Article 17, where one jurisdiction makes a primary adjustment to the profits of an enterprise, the other jurisdiction has to provide for a corresponding adjustment. It's also imperative to note, as far as domestic law is concerned, India has got the secondary adjustment provisions in place. Effect on CTA, Article 17 would apply, and it shall supersede CTA provision as far as Japan is concerned, since Japan has not made any reservation. Singapore Article 17, Singapore and UK 17 would not apply because there's already a provision contained in this. Arbitration and final provisions. Choice not to apply Part 6 arbitration. India has not applied for it. So therefore, all the issues can, unresolved MAP issues cannot go to arbitration. We feel it's a bilateral piece and we don't want a third party to come into this picture. Next, Article 35, entry into effect with respect to taxes withheld at source for non-residents. Events occurring 1st of January of the next calendar year that begins on or after the latest of the dates of MLIs. So which effectively means the entry into force for India would mean the 1st of April 2020. And for all the other three countries, it shall be 1st of April 2020. I mean, 1st of January 2020, because that begins our financial year. With respect to all other taxes, its taxable periods on or after the expiration of 6 months from the latest dates on which the MLI enters into force. So this has nothing much in terms of, tax implication. Similarly, Part 7, which deals with Article 27 to 33 and 36 to 39. All these are procedural provisions, friends. So these may not have any significant impact in terms of your tax positions. So when it comes to MLI, what we now need to understand is India's position on certain cases is distinctly different from how the countries with which India has a bilateral thing through. So while interpreting a DTA, you would have seen from now on how certain provisions are interpreted in the light of MLI. Our job is now, when you are giving an opinion or doing a structuring, our job is to focus more on understanding the provisions of DTA, read that in consonance with the MLI, and there are OECD guidelines, and the OECD website gives you, we can share the link as well, OECD websites which give you the MLI database. Please look into that before taking a final call on any opinion or structure. Thank you and have a great weekend, friends.